Hello, and thank you for joining us today. Our webinar today is Introduction to EPA Method 624, Level 101. Our presenter is Jeremiah Bradley, Applications Chemist for Teledyne Tekmar. We will be taking questions, so feel free to submit the questions throughout the presentation, and we will answer them at the end. This webinar is being recorded and will be available within a few days. So now I'm going to turn it over to our presenter, Jeremiah Bradley.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining me with what I hope will be a great resource for introducing EPA Method 624 Series 101. With today's topic being over Method 624, I would like to briefly introduce you to Persian Trap and talk a little bit about EPA Method 624 before I go over the core differences of each method and how they progress between both methods, specifically 624 and 624.1. If you have any questions, feel free to type them in as we go along, and I will try to answer them towards the best of my ability at the end of the presentation. To begin, let's start off with Persian Trap and how it works. First, the sample is collected, sealed, and stored in using a 40 milliliter VOA valve. The sample is later purged with an inert gas, causing the VOCs to be swept out of the sample matrix and deposited onto an analytical trap. Then, upon desorb, the trap is heated, and the VOCs are swept to the GC by backflushing the trap with the GC carrier gas into the column. The GC column then separates the concentrated compounds as they are carried to the mass spec detector for analysis, thus making the Persian Trap an excellent and efficient sample introduction technique for EPA Method 624. This brings us to the method. So what is EPA Method 624 series? There are a set of EPA methods used for the determination of purgeable organic compounds in municipal and industrial wastewater as provided under 40 Code of Federal Regulations 136.1. It is capable of determining selected analytes with precision and accuracies from reagent water, groundwater, and surface water and other environmental discharge water sources. This series is commonly used for environmental laboratories to monitor target compounds within related matrices or sources. In this webinar, I will take some time to briefly discuss the method QC requirement, the equipment involved, and the difference and similarities between 624 and its recent update of 624.1. As I mentioned before, the original purpose of creating 624 series was to analyze purgeable organic compounds in industry wastewater as an invested response source to Clean Water Act. This is just one of the many methods the EPA used as a strategy to monitor and report possible contaminants and wastewater industrial discharge. To accommodate for the various improvements made in Persian Trap and mass spec detector technology, an update was made in 624, leading to the current revision we have today of 624.1. 624.1 was introduced in 2016 to allow flexibility of the method parameters and analysis. This flexibility includes allowing the use of single ion monitoring, or SIMS, to target emerging contaminants of interest and troublesome compounds. Extended target compounds of interest were updated to include reformulated gasoline additives and potential breakdown of products of MTBE and other compounds, including those found in EPA Method 8260. With the reformation of gases, allowing for more Persian Trap and flexibility, we're able to see an increased throughput and purge efficiency. Naturally, this requires the QC definitions to be updated as well, as today we're able to reflect the better acceptable ranges, and we're able to talk more about these updates in an upcoming slide. Lastly, a noticeable difference between the update for 624 was the permissive use of hydrogen as a carrier gas, a great carrier gas alternative allowing you to save on expensive helium resources. Here's a quick overview of the changes between 624 to 624.1, along with some of their major differences. At first glance, there's a few big differences you'll notice between 624 and 624.1. First being the sample volume. 624.1 recommends 5 milliliters, and you can see you can use 25 depending on the level of sensitivity. 624 requires 5 mil samples. In 624.1, desorb and purge times are allowed to be optimized for performance base, whereas before in 624, the 4-minute desorb and the 11-minute purge could not be changed. 624.1 introduces the permitted use of RSEs and linear quadratic regression curves. but do note for RS response factors, RSDs, while 624 requires a minimum of 3 concentration levels, 624.1 recommends a minimum of 5, but no less than 3 depending on the max spec level of sensitivity, with a minimum of 6 levels for the second order or quadratic calibration. Only the lowest or the highest point can be dropped in the calibration curve. And lastly, with hydrogen being used as an alternative for the carrier gas, you may notice several behaviors when compared to traditional carrier gas like helium, such as faster retention time and slightly lower responses due to the nature of the gas, especially when observing compounds like chloroethane. EPA method 624.1 table 5 continues to provide a list of choices for internal standards and surrogates. The updated method still requires a minimum of 3 internal standards and 3 surrogates. You'll want to choose the surrogates that are closely matched to the purging characteristics of the target compounds of interest. Here's a table showing the modification parameters allowed for 624 and 624.1. Here we can see the key parameters which allows users to optimize their ideal purge and trap parameters. The latest method allows for parameters to be performance-based and optimized for target analytes of interest, providing the conditions are kept the same for all analysis and can pass QC criteria. 624 recommends a purging gas flow of 40 milliliters per minute. It's a little stricter in that the purge had to be for 11 minutes and the desorb had to be for 4 minutes. You cannot change these parameters. 624.1, however, allows for more flexibility to modify your purge and trap conditions. Here's a convenient table outlining the analytical equipment involved in 624 and the recommended requirements for your view. I wanted to take the time to point out a few of the key hardware requirements for 624. Standard hardware will include the purge and trap system, a gas chromatograph, and the mass spec detector, including the column and traps. When analyzing for chlorodifluoromethane, traps 3 and 10 cannot be used due to the trap inefficiency. It simply doesn't have the sorbent to hold it. The method recommends a quadrupole mass spec, but other types may be used provided the performance is not adversely affected. Scans requires a minimum of 5 scans per peak, but do not exceed 7 seconds per scan. The software should also allow calculations of response factor or construction or linear or second order regression calibration curve. Calculations of response factor statistics such as mean and standard deviation and calculation of concentration of analytes used in the calibration curve. Another key note to observe is with the permissive use of SIMS. You must use a minimum of 2 ions to identify the compounds of interest being used. BFB tune criteria remains the same for 624.1. For the most part, rather than daily, one should be tested every 12 hours. These criteria are for the quadrupole mass spec. And the BFB tune must be within 50 nanograms or less for injection. You may have seen mass ion 96 extend up to 15% when using hydrogen due to the nature of the gas. Here's a list comparing the methods target analytes of interest. The ones highlighted in yellow are per the method as QC compounds of interest, while the compounds left in white are compounds the methods can be extended to include as purgeable compounds. The method now allows 33 core compounds with alkaline and acrylonitrile officially being added to the method. Previously in the method 624, they were also just purgeable compounds. The method could be used for, or should I say, extended to. You can see the list was extended mainly due to the fact that 624 compound list was limited and outdated in targeted compounds of interest to include many compounds included in EPA method 8260. This update includes some ketones, acrylate, nitriles, and including nitrile benzene. As you continue to review the list, you will notice popular compounds like our reformulated gas additives were added, including TBA and ethers. Other target compounds of interest were added to the list, including NTBE byproducts and chlorodifluoromethane, opening the application of this method to a broader window for available analysis. Do note, though, analytes added to the method but not included in the method acceptance criteria may be based on your in-house laboratory control charts. To monitor the integrity of the samples and system accuracy and precision throughout the schedule analysis, 624.1 includes laboratory control samples. These control samples are used for calibration verification and are used to replace the former method 624 requirement for quality control samples. The method requires one laboratory control sample every 12-hour or work shift, or whenever a QC sample fails to confirm the integrity of the measurement of the sample in the system. Each laboratory control sample needs to meet the calibration check verification criteria and recovery. Next, there are the method detection limits, or MDLs, which is the lowest concentration a substance can be reported with 99% confidence of identity when compared to a method blank. Per the method, the MDL must be equal or lower than the values provided in Table 1 of the method, or one-third of the regulatory compliance limit. Lastly, there's the matrix spikes and matrix spike duplicates. They're used to observe the matrix effects per method constraint and parameters. This method requires 5% of batch samples or one matrix spike and one matrix spike duplicate per batch of 20 samples prepared from the same source as an initial calibration. In the aspect of monitoring and reporting, these are the minimum core principles that are important in QC guidelines to justify sample integrity as maintained throughout and schedule. These are also the pillars for troubleshooting when a problem may occur when reviewing your analysis. If a sample or QC fails, you're allowed to retest for the analyte that fails, providing you don't make any adjustments or do any system maintenance. If failure continues, correct the issue and repeat the initial demonstration of capability before continuing with sample and blanks. 624.1 does permit in-house QC limits in which 80% of the target analyte's acceptance criteria are stricter than that listed in Table 7 of EPA Method 624.1 method. The remaining 20% must meet the normal passing criteria. Method parameters and analysis must be kept in the same for the LCS, blanks, and sample, as well as the matrix spikes and matrix spike duplicates. Per each method is a detailed platform of the method QC requirements that has to be followed to assure and justify integrity of the instrument in the sample analysis. This table demonstrates the core requirements of the EPA method 624 and is here for your review. In the upcoming slide, you will also be able to compare with 624.1 requirements. Here's the QC guidelines for 624.1, listing all the criteria and terms you should become familiar with for your review as well. Here you can see the criteria that replaced it QCS and LCS in EPA method 624.1. They provide the same purpose and function in that they are made in the lab as a working standard from a second source independent of the initial calibration curve standard source. In general, we use these terminology and QC requirements to monitor and evaluate the integrity of the system while evaluating the samples. Using these guidelines, we're able to assure the quality of the instrument remains consistent throughout the scheduled sample analysis. As you may recall, with the permissive use of quadratic curves, the method requires the 6 points rather than a traditional five point. And you may also notice the laboratory control spike requires a tighter window for drift acceptance of plus or minus 10 seconds compared to the previous window of 30 seconds. As I said before, the laboratory MDLs must be equal or lower than those listed in Table 1 for those analytes, which listed MDL values must be one-third of the regulatory compliance limits or whichever is greater. But those ranges may range from not determined to 7.2 ppb. The method parameters and analysts must be kept in the same for the liquid or the LCS, blank samples, and matrix spikes and matrix spike duplicates. Here's a convenient table with a brief detail summarizing the sample handling. Prior to analysis, usually upon being sealed, the sample is treated for pH level and dechlorination. Dechlorination agents include sodium disulfate, ascorbic acid, and sodium sulfate. pH adjustments are made with hydrochloric acid. Calibration standards should be stored at negative 10 to 20 degrees Celsius and protected from light. Samples containing benzene, toluene, ethylbenzene are susceptible to degradation under certain environmental conditions. Acidify to 2 pH to prolong your sample up to a maximum hold time of 14 days. You should analyze your samples within 3 days if acrolein is present. Use hydrochloric acid to prolong if necessary. Do note hydrochloric acid will destroy 2 cleaves. Store your samples between 0 degrees Celsius to 6 degrees Celsius until analysis. I also wanted to take some time to list some helpful conversions for calculating some basis equations used to make standards or identify targeted calculations. These are the ones I like to use personally within a lab to help me keep track of conversions. These methods are easy to use and are adapted to in lab. Challenges you may face due to environmental impact causing background levels and sample contamination. This is especially common with methylene chloride, acetone, and carbon disulfide. You may also experience water vapor colluding or impacting your sensitivity and peak shape. These are also issues you can address and correct through within your Persian trap parameters by optimizing your settings. And with that, I'd like to say thank you for attending this webinar. Are there any questions?
Yes, I just assigned a question to you, Jeremiah.
DOC and LCS description may have been switched.
Oh, that's okay. That's not something that we need to address. Okay, I want to thank everybody for attending, and this webinar and the recording and the slide deck will be available in a few days. Thank you.
Thank you.